Hi, I'm Mary Sue Rominger. I'm on the board of directors and a volunteer for the Bateman Horne Center. I'd like to welcome everyone and thank you so much for being here tonight, joining us. We will post a video of tonight's presentation on our YouTube channel within the next few days. So if you want to take a look at the presentation again, then you can use the video to do so. We also plan to do a Q&A at the end of the program. So if you'll save your questions till the end, and those on Facebook Live, please use the comment section to ask your questions. Our speaker tonight is Dr. Jordan Rullo, and Dr. Rullo's talk is The Art of Good Enough Sex and Good Enough Days. And I just really love that title. I thought it was so appropriate for this audience. In her presentation, she will be discussing sexual health for those with ME/CFS and fibromyalgia. Dr. Rullo holds several certifications. She is a board-certified clinical health psychologist, also a certified sex therapist through the American Association of Sex Educators, Counselors, and Therapists, and she is a certified Gottman therapist. Dr. Rullo holds an appointment as an adjunct assistant professor of clinical psychology at the University of Utah, and also holds a research collaborator position in the Division of General Internal Medicine at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Please welcome Dr. Jordan Rullo.
Well, thank you all for being here. My talk today is Fatigue, Fibro, and Sexual Health, The Art of Good Enough Sex on Good Enough Days. So let's get started. Learning objectives for this presentation: to recall the Good Enough Sex model, to describe realistic sexual expectations with chronic pain, to explain how to broaden your sexual menu, and to recall ways to conserve energy and limit pain to engage in sexual activity. All right. I don't have enough energy for sex. This is a 44-year-old heterosexual married woman with CFS. My body doesn't feel sexual. It feels like more like my enemy. This is a 39-year-old lesbian married woman with fibromyalgia. I can't enjoy sex when I'm in constant pain. This is a 28-year-old heterosexual woman with fibromyalgia. If any of you have had these thoughts, have experienced these symptoms, then I'm so glad you're here, because I'm going to share with you ways to address these issues. Let's just talk for a moment about the impact of CFS and fibro on sexual health. Let's start first with women with fibromyalgia. What percentage of women, this is a question for the audience, what percentage of women with fibromyalgia would you say have sexual dysfunction? So sexual dysfunction is difficulty with arousal, difficulty with orgasm, pain with sexual activity, or low sexual desire. What percentage, women with fibromyalgia, what would you say? Yell it out.
50%.
Anybody else?
60%.
Are you ready? So 75%, right? It's a big number, a big number. Okay, what about women with chronic fatigue syndrome? Again, women with chronic fatigue syndrome who have sexual dysfunction. How many? What percentage? 75%. Any other guesses? We'll go with 75. 60%. Now, there's not much data on men with fibro or CFS. Really, the best data we have is on women. So we have a little bit of data on men. How many more times likely would you say a man with CFS is who has erectile dysfunction? So if you're a man with CFS, you are how many more times likely to have erectile dysfunction? 3 times, 7 times, 2 times? How many more times likely to have ED?
3. 3?
2 times. Long story short, CFS and fibro have a major impact on the sexual health of both men and women, a major impact. Yet, despite this, CFS and fibro do not take away your sexuality. They do not. It may feel like it, but that's not the case. And here's what does change. They may take away your sexual script. Now, when I talk about sexual script, think about this. Think about kind of the routine maybe you and your partner have. I do this, then he or she does this, and then I respond this way, or maybe when we're in bed, she nudges me or he nudges me, right? Typically, couples have this routine. And within that routine, there's also some expectations about how each person should perform sexually. There's a script, typically, with couples. CFS and fibro will more than likely take away that script. Things are going to work and look differently, and that routine that you used to have is probably going to be a different routine now, or may not even be a routine. What I am going to argue is to throw away that old script. That old script is not helpful. If you continue to demand that your sexual performance or that your sexual routine or script looks like what it used to look like, or looks like what it used to look like before you had symptoms, then you're probably going to continue to be disappointed. So throw away that old script and write a new one. And we're going to talk about what this new script looks like. It's called Good Enough Sex on Good Enough Days. So first we're going to talk about good enough sex, what it means when I say good enough sex, and then we're going to spend the second half of this presentation talking about what I mean when I say good enough days. Good enough sex. There are a few key principles to good enough sex. And the first principle is the ultimate goal of sex is not performance. And we'll talk about what that means. Second key principle is you need to have realistic sexual expectations. We'll also talk about what that means. And the third key principle is having variable, flexible sex. And we'll also talk about what that means. But let's start with the first one. The ultimate goal of sex is not performance. Now, think about this. What is the ultimate goal of sex? When I ask the clients that I see what their goal of sex is, oftentimes they look at me with a weird look like, what are you asking, duh? But really think about that. Would you say it's orgasm? Is it pleasure? Now imagine you had an amazing orgasm, but your partner was totally checked out during the whole sexual experience. You might say like, yeah, I mean, the orgasm was nice, but I wouldn't say it was that great. And I think the reason that's the case is the ultimate goal for sex is really connection. The pleasure may be wonderful, but if your partner is not connected with you and there's not reciprocity, oftentimes couples will say, it wasn't that great. So I'm going to argue that really the ultimate goal of sex is connection. And so now think about this. If the ultimate goal of sex is connection, what ingredients need to be in place to connect? Do you have to have a specific script, a specific sexual routine, in order to connect? Probably not. Does there have to be orgasm in order to connect with your partner intimately and sexually? Probably not. Does it have to be a perfect performance, whatever that means, in order to connect with your partner sexually? Probably not. So if the ultimate goal of sex is connection, think about the possibilities this opens up. This isn't about a particular routine. This isn't about a particular script. You don't have to perform in a certain way. You don't have to reach a certain milestone or have an orgasm in a certain way. If this is really about connection, this opens up so many possibilities of what sex and intimacy can look like. Now, the second principle of good enough sex is realistic sexual expectations. Let's talk about that. In the general population, and this is kind of mind-blowing, but in the general population, less than half of sexual experiences will be very good for both people. Less than half. Think about that. Oftentimes when I work with couples and I'll ask them, you know, what percentage of sexual experiences do you think are very good for both people in the couple? And they'll say, oh, like 95, 90%. Now, what we know from the research is less than half are going to be very good for both people. So you, and this is the general population, this isn't even people with CFS and fibro. So a realistic expectation when it comes to a sexual relationship, sexual encounters, is that less than half the time it's going to be very good for both. The other half the time, maybe it's good for one and just kind of acceptable for the other. Maybe it's good for one and just fine for the other. Maybe it actually wasn't that good for both people. So typically in the general population, sex is not Hollywood sex. It's realistic expectations. The second really important piece when it comes to realistic expectations is to know your sexual desire. Now, there are two different types of sexual desire. Society typically only talks about one of them, but there's a second one that is equally important that we typically don't hear about in sex education if we've even had sex education. So I want to talk about both of these because they're both very, very important when you think about realistic sexual expectations. The first type of sexual desire is what's called spontaneous desire. And that's that type of desire where you have that internal drive, that internal craving, just spontaneously you're like, yeah, I really want to have sex right now. Okay, so that's spontaneous desire. And the second type of desire that isn't talked about as much, but again, equally important, is called willingness desire. So willingness desire goes like this. In willingness desire, you're sexually neutral. Sex is not on your mind. But the ingredients are in place that allow you to be willing to be sexual. So maybe those ingredients are, you've got some energy, you're not in much pain in that moment, you feel connected to your partner, there's privacy, your partner initiates, and you're like, huh, yeah, I wasn't thinking about sex, it wasn't on my mind, but sure, I'd be willing. And then typically, people say that once they're willing to be sexual, the once a sexual activity actually gets started, then they're like, that's kind of nice. And then once it's done, they're like, gosh, you know, we should do this more often. Now, that's willingness desire. It is equally important as spontaneous desire, but they're different. Now, let me show you pictorially what willingness desire looks like, what this responsive, receptive willingness desire looks like. This is the, let's see if my pointer works. So I'll do a little Vanna White action. But this is the circular model of sexual response. This is the model of willingness desire. And as you can see, it's a circle, right? Makes sense, it's called the circular model. There's two ways you can jump into this circle. So one way you jump into the circle of sexually responding is that you happen to have spontaneous desire. That's that box right in the middle, spontaneous sexual drive. So let's say you happen to have just that spontaneous sexual drive. You think, gosh, I really wanna have sex right now. And that leads you to maybe seek out some sort of sexual stimuli. Or maybe if you take the arrow below, that leads you to feel arousal in that moment. And that's what kickstarts your sexual response. Now that may be one way that your sexual response starts. You just happen to be spontaneous. If you have CFS or fibro, that is probably not the way that your sexual response is going to get kickstarted. Instead, your sexual response is probably going to get kickstarted more with that willingness or that receptivity. So you see in the top right, it says being receptive to. So let's say you're receptive. All those ingredients are in place. First thing that's going to happen is going to be some sort of sexual stimuli. Perhaps it's your partner initiating sex. As long as biologically and psychologically everything's doing okay, those ingredients are in place, you're not in too much pain, you don't have too much fatigue in that moment, you're not super stressed out or depressed, the first thing that's going to happen is sexual arousal. Now, this is important. The first thing that happens is sexual arousal. Your body starts to physiologically respond, and then on the coattails of arousal comes desire. Okay, so what this looks like is body starts to respond, and then your mind goes, oh yeah, that's nice. So body gets started first, and then mind comes on the coattails with saying, yeah, I kind of like this. That leads to, if you follow the arrow up, some sort of emotional and physical satisfaction. Now, some people might define satisfaction as orgasm, but there are so many different ways to define sexual satisfaction. That leads you to feel emotionally intimate with your partner, which then leads you to be receptive towards sexual stimuli in the future, and this cycle just repeats itself. This is the circular response cycle that really shows this willingness desire. And I can't stress enough how arousal comes before desire. The body's got to get kickstarted first. And then the mind goes, well, yeah, that's kind of nice. Now, this is probably going to be different if you have a partner who does not have CFS or fibro. If you have a partner that is predominantly driven by spontaneous desire, this is probably going to be their sexual response model. Now, this is called the linear model. It's called the linear model because it's just a line, right? Kind of like a roller coaster. The way the linear model starts is with desire. It starts with desire. Now, the other model I just showed you started with arousal. Body's got to get kickstarted first. But this one starts with desire. So basically, the mind says, yeah, kind of want to have sex right now. And then that leads to arousal, which leads to orgasm and the resolution phase. This one starts differently. If you have a partner who does not have CFS or fibro, who does not have a chronic health condition, this may be their model. So when they think about being sexual, they think, yeah, I have desire. I think, gosh, I want to have sex right now, and then I pursue it. But that is not going to be where you're coming from. In your model, you're not thinking about it. Things have to get kickstarted, ingredients have to be in place, body gets started, and then mind goes, oh yeah, I kind of want this. So neither is right or wrong, it's just two different ways to approach being sexual and intimate. And you may have a different way, willingness, compared to your partner, which may be more spontaneous. So when we talk about realistic expectations for CFS and fibro, with chronic pain and fatigue, willingness is probably going to become your predominant desire. And if we think about this more overarching, this willingness is actually pretty similar to the willingness for other activities. So if many of you have seen physicians for fibro or CFS, they've probably told you something like, do what you can as long as you can. And that's the same with willingness. If you're willing to be sexual, if you have that receptivity, do what you can as long as you can. Because if you find yourself avoiding it, just like you may avoid other activities, that avoidance is going to lead to more avoidance. Okay, now let's talk about the third principle of good enough sex, variable, flexible sex. it's important to have a broad sexual and intimate menu. I have a lot of couples that I see that have a very narrow definition of what sex is. So for example, particularly with my heterosexual couples, they will define sex as penile-vaginal penetration, period, that's it. That's a very narrow definition. There are so many other things that one can do that are sexual and intimate. So the couples that I work with, I will actually give them a non-penetrative sexual menu. So I've got a menu that's double-sided. It has a whole list on each side of all different non-penetrative sexual activities. And there's a rating scale at the top of that menu. 1, I would love to do this. 5, no way. And so what I'll do with couples to help them build a broader sexual menu is I'll give them each this menu and say, okay, go in your separate corners and I want you to rate your willingness to engage in all these different sexual activities. And then come back together and compare your ratings. And everything you two have rated pretty highly, those are the things I want you two to try. That's the start of your sexual menu. If you are looking for a sexual menu online, there's a really neat website called Mojo Upgrade. I will give you a warning, it's adventurous. It is for the adventurous. But what Mojo Upgrade is it's a website where you log in, your partner logs in, and it gives you a whole list of different sexual activities, like a lot of different sexual activities. And you get to rate your willingness to engage in each of these. And then both of you rate. It gives you then a printout of just the things you two have matched on, just the things that you two are both willing to engage in. So that's another way to broaden your sexual menu. An additional way is to think about the fact that it actually doesn't have to be sex. You can be intimate and you can be sensual and physical with each other, and it doesn't have to be sex. There are many, many really nice sensual activities. Massage, showering together. There's a new thing, I don't know how new it is, but I recently heard about it, body brushing. So you can buy a brush specifically for the body and brush each other's bodies, just holding each other. One of the favorite exercises that I like to work with couples on is something called sensate focus. And I want to share some of the brief foundational pieces of sensate focus, because this could be another thing that you and your partner could do in lieu of sex, right? This is very sexual and intimate. So sensate focus, these are exercises designed, they were developed in the 1960s by Masters and Johnson, and what these are is touching exercises. These are gradual touching exercises, about 10 phases to these exercises, and I'm just going to tell you about phase 1. But this is a way to just touch with your partner and not have any pressure or any demand for you to perform in any particular way, for any particular thing to happen. In fact, sensate focus is not supposed to lead to sex. This is just sensual touching. So let me describe this basics of these exercises. In a private space, you do 20 to 30 minutes of full body touch. Full body touch. So this is in between the toes, behind the ears, behind the knees. Like you're touching the whole body. You're nude to whatever extent feels comfortable. So if it's more comfortable for you to have some level of clothing on, that's fine. So you're nude to whatever extent feels comfortable, and no sexual activity is allowed. In sensate focus, you are just touching. This is not about having sex. Because if there's a lot of pressure and demand and maybe baggage around your sexual relationship, and you think that doing these touching exercises is gonna eventually lead to sex, you're probably gonna say like, no, I don't wanna do it because we're just touching to eventually lead to sex. So this is just touching to touch, just touching to reconnect. You do it every 48 to 72 hours to kind of maintain that momentum. And the phases build upon each other. So I'm gonna share with you phase 1, but know there are 10 phases. So these are exercises that you could do for months to try to reconnect with your partner. So sensate focus phase 1 is like this. There's no touching. Breast, chest, and genitals. So those are off limits just for the first phase. But again, the whole body is on limits. Again, no sex. Nonverbal. So as you're touching and being touched, you're not talking. You're just touching. Full body touching. The whole body, except for at least this phase, no breast, chest, genitals. And you take turns. So your partner touches you. Let's say if you do this for 30 minutes, your partner's going to touch you for 15 minutes, and then you two are going to switch, and you're going to touch your partner for 15 minutes. Use your hands and fingers only. I have a lot of couples that do these exercises, and they try to get real crafty and say, like, can we touch with our tongues? No, hands and fingers only. And you focus on sensation. So the whole reason these exercises are called sensate focus exercises is your role while you're touching and while you're being touched is to focus on sensations. 3 sensations in particular. Temperature, so you're touching, you're thinking, oh, is this warm, is this cool? Pressure, is this firm, is this soft? Texture, is this rough, is this smooth? TPT, temperature, pressure, texture. You're focusing on sensations, whether you're the toucher or the one being touched, you're focusing on sensations. these particular sensations, because they're vivid, they can capture your immediate attention, and they're reliable. They're always available. So even if you've noticed possibly sensation changes in your body because of CFS or fibro, these sensations are still there. They're reliable sensations. So as you're touching and being touched, you're focusing on these sensations. Again, sensate focus exercises are a great way to reconnect, to have some sensual intimacy without that pressure for sex. Now, just a quick take home on this good enough sex model. One, connection is the ultimate goal. Two, realistic sexual expectations are very important. This is not going to be Hollywood sex. Actually, for the general population, it isn't Hollywood sex. And willingness desire is probably going to be your main desire if you have CFS or fibro. And that may not be the main desire for your partner. Your partner's main desire may be spontaneous. And think about really having a broad sexual menu, which might include sensate focus. Okay, so we've talked about good enough sex. Now let's talk about on good enough days. What does that mean? So good enough days are when there is more on the gas pedal than on the brake pedal. And let me explain what that means. I have to explain something called the dual control model to explain this. And the dual control model sounds super nerdy, but it's actually really, really interesting. So for all of us, when it comes to our sexual function, we have a brake pedal and we have a gas pedal. And in order for sexual function to function, you need to have more on your gas than on your brake. So in order for this to be a good enough day, this needs to be more on the gas than on the brake. Now, examples of things that might hit that brake pedal. Body image. If you're not feeling good about your body, you probably don't want to be sexual. Of course, fatigue, pain. Maybe you're experiencing some depression and anxiety. Those are all things that are going to hit that brake pedal. Gas pedal things. You feel emotionally connected with your partner. Your partner is looking good. Maybe there's some novelty in the relationship. Those are all gas pedal things, okay? So again, in order for sexual function to function, in order for this to be a good enough day, you need to have more on that gas than on that brake. Now I want to describe for you the most common things that hit the brake pedal. And the easy way to describe it is to kind of organize it in this biopsychosocial model. I'm going to go through this model, physiological, psychological, relationship, social, cultural, and describe again the most common things that hit that brake pedal. Let's start with physiological, most common things. Pain, of course, right? If you're experiencing pain, that's definitely going to hit the brake pedal to want to be sexual. If you're tired, so I'll ask clients that I work with, you know, at the end of the day, if someone hands you a platter of sex or a platter of sleep, which platter are you going to take? And if they tell me sleep's the platter they're going to take, then fatigue is probably something hitting the brake pedal. Medications, right? There are a number of medications that are going to impact your ability to have arousal, to feel desire. Aging, we know with aging, when it comes to sexual function, everything just takes longer and is less intense. Arousal takes longer, orgasm takes longer, these things are less intense. Psychological, emotional factors, the greatest things that hit the brake pedal. Anxiety. So a little bit of anxiety actually can be helpful, but a lot of anxiety, not helpful at all. The way I kind of wrap my head around anxiety is, imagine that you're back in a cave people days, and you're a cave person, and you wake up, and you happen to be kind of aroused and maybe interested in sex as you wake up, and you walk outside of your cave and you know, you're aroused, and then you see a rustle in the bushes and there's a lion. So in that moment, you see that lion, threat. Your anxiety kicks in and your mind says, there's a threat. I have got to fight that lion or I have got to run. So if there was any blood in your genitals because you happen to be aroused for that moment, that blood is leaving your genitals and it is going to your extremities because you have got to fight this lion or you've got to run. So high anxiety essentially tells us there is a threat and I'm scanning the environment for threat, and in this moment I do not need blood in my genitals to scan this environment for threat. And in fact, if you told the lion, hey, Mr. Lion, I'm just going to lay down in this grassy knoll and have some sex, what's going to happen? The lion's going to eat you, right? So high anxiety does not work well when it comes to sexual function. Depression, really common hitting that brake pedal, because when you think about depression, already you're having difficulty with motivation, difficulty feeling joy. Poor body image, I mentioned this before, but if you're not feeling very sexy, it's going to be difficult to want to be sexual. History of sexual abuse or trauma, if the sexual activity reminds you of a history of trauma or brings flashbacks, it's probably going to be difficult to want to be sexual. Distraction, this one's actually really common. I will ask clients that I work with, so when you're actually having sex, what are you thinking about? And what I will commonly hear is, oh, I'm thinking about my to-do list, I'm thinking about the kids. So distraction is really common in hitting that brake pedal. Now let's talk about relationship. Most common things that hit the relationship brake pedal. discord. If you are arguing or fighting with your partner, probably don't want to be sexual with them. No emotional intimacy. If you don't feel connected with them, probably don't want to be sexual with them. And remember that circular sexual response model that I showed you? The top box in that model was emotional intimacy. If emotional intimacy isn't there, that is a break in that cycle. So emotional intimacy is really important if willingness desire is your main desire. If your partner has a sexual dysfunction, you are actually more likely to have a sexual dysfunction. And inadequate stimulation. If the right buttons aren't being pushed when you're being sexual with your partner, you may not be all that interested or willing or motivated to be sexual. So all these things will hit the brake pedal. And lack of privacy. I've talked to so many couples where they'll say, gosh, you know, when I'm actually having sex, I'm worried that the kids are going to come in the room. And I'll say, okay, well, why don't you lock the door? I've even had couples who have said, oh, well, we don't even have a door in our bedroom. What? You don't have a door? Go to Menards and get a door. Step number one. So privacy can really kind of take a hit for the breaks. And then finally, social cultural factors that hit that brake pedal. Limited sex education can hit that brake pedal. Maybe you're experiencing some sort of conflict with religious, personal, or family values, or societal taboos may be getting in the way and hitting that brake pedal. Bottom line, good enough days are when there is more on the gas pedal than on the brake pedal. So now what do you do with this? What I'd want you to do, you can do this at home, you can do this next week, but take a piece of paper and draw this out. This is essentially the biopsychosocial model. So you're gonna have four columns: biological, psychological, relationship, and life stuff, which is that socio-cultural kind of catch-all. You've got these four columns, and I want you to go through in all these four columns and indicate every possible thing that is hitting your brake pedal. Because here's the important piece with this gas pedal and this brake pedal. Most people, when they're trying to figure out, well, what's my good enough day or what's interfering with my sexual function, their mind goes right to gas. And they think, well, gosh, you know, my desire's low, or I'm having difficulty with arousal and orgasm, so I know how to treat this. Gas pedal. Maybe we need date nights. Maybe we need to light some candles. Maybe I need some lingerie, right? People's minds go right to, what can I jam on that gas pedal? But it's actually not that helpful. Because if you think about this brake pedal and gas pedal is like a car, right? And so you've got the, let's say you've got the brake pedal pushed all the way to the ground, and then you decide, oh, I want to put some weight on that gas. What's going to happen to your car? It's going to squeal. It's not going to go anywhere. If you have a ton of stuff pushed on that brake pedal, the gas pedal is irrelevant. It doesn't matter how many date nights, lingerie, lighting of candles that you're doing. It doesn't matter. The gas pedal is irrelevant if the brake pedal is pushed all the way to the ground. So the first step in really trying to figure out what are my good enough days and what's going to help with my sexual function is figuring out what is on your gas pedal and removing as much stuff as possible off of that gas pedal. And this is a great way to try to identify what is on your gas pedal. Now you'll put down these four columns, and then in each column, start to write down every possible thing that is on your gas pedal. Well, biologically, yes, I do have pain, and psychologically, I am feeling anxious lately, and so you'll start to fill this out. And so maybe a typical client I see will say, yes, I've got pain. That's hitting my brake pedal. And I've been depressed since this diagnosis. I've been arguing with my partner, and I'm stressed out because I'm in the sandwich generation, and I'm taking care of my mother and assisted living and my kids. So this may be the things on your brake pedal. Then what I want you to do, and you may have a lot more than this on your brake pedal, but let's say you've got the sheet all filled out, all the things that are hitting your brakes. Really look at that sheet and say, okay, of all these things, what of these have the greatest weight? And then circle those. And you may have maybe 2, 3, 4 that you circle, where you'd really ask yourself, you know, if this wasn't an issue, if I could remove this from my brake pedal, I would be much more willing to be sexual. That would be a better day for me, a more good enough day. So circle all those things that have the greatest weight, and that's the next step. So maybe you've circled 3 or 4 things. Those are the things to address, and then it becomes problem solving. What do we do with these 3 or 4 things? Is there any way we can change these things? So let me give you an example. Let's say a woman with CFS or fibro says, of course, fatigue and pain are on her brakes. But she also says, and I get headaches frequently. And psychologically, she feels broken. She feels unsexy because she feels broken. And she's having symptoms of depression because of that. And then she worries that her partner's gonna leave her because she thinks, well, why do they wanna be with me? Because I feel broken. They're gonna find someone else. And when it comes to the relationship, their partner is avoiding initiating sex for fear of rejection, right? Their partner has initiated sex so many times and, you know, the person doesn't, she doesn't feel good, doesn't want to, so they say, you know, I'm just going to stop initiating. And because of that, there's a real decrease in that emotional connection because of this lack of sexual intimacy. And also they have two kids who live at home, so that impacts privacy and that's just a lot more stress. So this may be kind of the typical woman who has CFS or fibro. And then I'll ask her, okay, these are all the things hitting your brake pedal. What of these have the greatest weight? And she looks at this and says, you know, despite all this stuff, I would have to say the fatigue and the pain are the two things that have the greatest weight. Okay, then this is what we start to problem solve. So let me break this down. I'm just going to give you a brief summary of this. To gather the necessary data to figure out what your good enough days are, you've got to identify what are the heaviest things on your brake pedal. Now, this person said fatigue and pain, but I want you to be aware that CFS and fibro and the symptoms of that, they may actually not be the heaviest thing on your brake pedal. You may think, yeah, they've got to be the heaviest thing on my brake pedal, but perhaps as you're filling out the sheet, you realize, oh, actually, I started to experience these sexual health concerns before the symptoms. Perhaps it's related to my relationship with my partner or some other stressor that went on. So don't just assume that the CFS, fibro, and those symptoms are what have the greatest weight on the brake pedal. Now, that was true for this person, but they may not be true for you. Use these factors, these things hitting the brake pedal, to determine your good enough days by problem solving. So let's problem solve the fatigue and the pain. When it comes to fatigue, sexual activity is actually equal to briskly walking up a hill. So it's about the same caloric burn as briskly walking up a hill. So it's exercise. And if you don't have much energy, you're probably not that interested in exercising. So if you think about it as exercise, prepare for sex like it's an exercise routine. Pace yourself. Go as slow as you need. Take medications when you think they'll be the most helpful. You could also plan for sex when you have the most energy during the day. So if you know you have more energy in the morning, maybe that's when sex happens. If you have more energy in the evening, maybe that's when sex happens. And you can experiment with different sexual positions that actually require less energy expenditure. Or perhaps your partner is the one that is doing more energy expenditure than you. If you have pain, if that's the biggest thing on your brake pedal, again, experiment with sexual positions that involve less pain. Plan sex for the time of the day when you have less pain. Maybe you're saying, well, yeah, that's great, Jordan, but the pain's not predictable. The pain, the fatigue, these symptoms may not be predictable. Often they're not predictable, which could be super frustrating. If that's the case, then think about planning a counter bid to connect. And I'm going to explain what a counter bid to connect is. So remember, let's go back to the three key principles of the good enough sex model. The principle number one was the ultimate goal of sex is connection. So you can assume that if your partner is initiating sexual activity, they're essentially saying, I want to connect with you. They are what we call giving a bid for connection. This is a couples therapy phrase. It's from Gottman Couples Therapy. It's a bid of connection. So I'll explain what this is. Couples interact through bids of connection. And a bid is a gesture, whether it's verbal or nonverbal, to connect with your partner. We know that couples who are happy respond to bids positively. So they will turn towards their partner's bid. And a bid could be super simple. A bid could be like, oh gosh, it's kind of overcast today. And then you say like, yeah, it is. Me posing that question and you responding, that was a bid. And the fact that you responded, you just turned toward my bid. When you turned toward my bid and said, yeah, it is pretty overcast, you were essentially saying, I hear you. I understand you. I also want to connect. Oh, I'm interested in what you have to say. That is turning towards a bid. Now, let me give you some examples of turning towards a bid. If you respond to your partner's joke, doesn't mean you have to think it's funny, but if you respond to it, if you help them solve a problem, if you show active interest in their accomplishments, they come home and say, oh my gosh, you just got a promotion. Oh, that's great. If you respond to their simple requests, if you pay attention to what they're saying, maybe if you're willing to be sexual, all of these are turning toward your partner's bids. Now, this is different from turning away from a bid. Now, let me give you examples of turning away from a bid. You can turn away with disinterest. You could be glued to your cell phone. So I say like, gosh, it's kind of overcast today. And you're just on your phone. You don't even respond. Just turned away my bid. Maybe you're just simply not interested in the weather. Or maybe you just go like, uh-huh. So you're not really listening. You just said, uh-huh. You can also turn away with disgust. So that's being contemptuous, belligerent, domineering. So I say, gosh, it's kind of overcast today. And you say, well, who cares what the weather is? Like, ooh, okay, well, that's a turn away. Now, why is this important? These bids fill your emotional bank account. And your emotional bank account is a relationship bank account, and the balance of that bank account determines how safe and secure you feel in the relationship. So it's a joint bank account where both partners can put in money and they can withdraw. These bids are what fill this account. Every time you turn towards your partner, you accept a bid. Imagine that as a penny in your bank account. Every time you turn away from a bid, you are taking 5 pennies out. So when you turn away from a bid, when you're glued to your cell phone or you mindlessly say, that's 5 pennies taken out of that bank account. And I have just a phenomenal graphic to show you this. So every time you turn toward a bid, bam, there's a penny. Every time you turn away from a bid, woof, 5 pennies out. So a turn away is really, really powerful. Now let's do a little quiz. Divorced couples, what percentage of time would you say that divorced couples turn toward a bid? They accept a bid. What percentage of time? These are divorced couples.
These are partners that were in the divorce.
These are partners who ended up getting divorced.
So you're talking after the divorce.
During their relationship.
When they were married.
When they were married, yes.
Okay.
How often do you, what percentage of time do you think that they turn toward and accepted bids from each other?
15%.
15%? 33% of the time.
I was gonna say 30.
What do you think about happy couples, those who are not divorced, who are happy in their relationship? 86% of the time.
Really?
Wow. Turning toward your partner, their bids, is really powerful. It can make a happy couple. Turning away is also really powerful. It can make a very unhappy couple. Happy couples, we know, turn toward each other 5 times for every 1 turn away. That is how they do not create a deficit in that emotional bank account. They have a 5-to-1 ratio. 5 accepting, 5 turn towards, with 1 turn away. Now, why is this relevant? We're talking about sexual health. Why is this relevant? Because if you have too many brakes on your brake pedal, and you aren't up for being sexual in that moment, or maybe you're not even up for being totally sensual or physical, you can still turn towards your partner with a counter bid. Think about their initiating of sexual or sensual activity as a bid for connection. You don't have to want to do that particular thing they're proposing, but they're saying, I want to connect with you. You can counter bid and say, okay, could we do sensate focus? Could we cuddle? Could we do that body brushing? They want to connect with you. Is there some other way that you can counter bid in order to connect with them? It would be helpful to discuss a menu of counter bids before sex is ever initiated. Maybe you've got 5 or 10 things that you know are great counter bids. So if you're just not in the mood that day, or you have too much pain, or you don't have that energy, and they initiate, you know you can go to your list and say, okay, I'm not into that, but I could, can I bid this? Can I do this? Because I still want to connect with you. Okay, so we've talked about a number of things related to pain. There's one more thing I want to talk about, how to address if pain is the biggest thing on your brake pedal, and that's sexual accessories. There's a really great website called ergoerotics.com, and this is a website that sells basically kind of sexual furniture. So you may, because of pain or fatigue, need to have some sort of sexual accessory or furniture to prop your body up in a certain way so you're expending less energy or not feeling that same amount of pain. So they have things like an inflatable wedge cushion. The woman who runs this website, she's a sexologist, PhD, and she will actually, you can schedule to have a consultation with her, and you can talk all about, here are my needs, here's my pain, here's my energy level, and she will walk you through different accessories that will help with your particular needs. Another great sexual accessory are vibrators. So these are sexual devices that may reduce pain or it may just require less energy. My favorite vibrator is at Lilo.com. So they sell some really high quality vibrators. This is the GG2. The reason why I like this one is it could be used both for penetrative sexual activity and for external non-penetrative sexual activity. So it gives you multiple options. But this is a way if you are tired, if you don't have that energy, it's something you can add into the mix. The overall take home for good enough sex on good enough days. When it comes to good enough sex, connection is the ultimate goal. Your main desire is more than likely willingness desire, and sex will not be Hollywood sex. Think about having a broad sexual menu, and that may include sensate focus. When it comes to good enough days, identify the heaviest issues on your brake pedal, right? Because if you think about this as a car, and you've got that brake pushed all the way to the ground, adding stuff to the gas pedal doesn't help. So identify the heaviest issues on your brake. Don't assume that the symptoms of CFS and fibro are the heaviest issues on your brake. They may not be. problem solve those issues to really maximize the likelihood of having a good enough day, and then pre-plan counter bids if there are too many brakes on the brake pedal for that particular day. Finally, consider some sexual accessories. And that is it. Thank you all very much. So I think it's question and answer time.
Should I have been taking notes, or do you have something out, or do we just go back and watch this at the Bateman Horne site so that we can take notes?
I don't have handouts, but I believe this will be at the Bateman Horne site, so you can watch it again and again and again.
Yeah, we'll post it on our YouTube channel in a few days. So.
Oh, yeah. I didn't even know you had a YouTube channel.
Yeah, okay. We have a lot of videos on YouTube channel.
Okay, yeah.
I think one of the interesting things about this is that it's, you know, I don't have any CFS or fibro, but I totally related to the willingness, desire aspect.
Yes.
So, you know, I don't think, yeah, and it was a beautiful, generalizable.
And that's such a great point. So that willingness model, we know that individuals where their main desire is willingness, those are typically women. Typically women who are older, postmenopausal, and also individuals who report chronic health concerns. Those are the individuals where willingness is often their main desire.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And it can be tricky, right? Because if you have a partner and their willingness is not their model is that spontaneous desire, they're looking at you like, well, what? What's going on? Or I have a lot of partners that say, well, I don't want to force her to be sexual. I mean, I don't want to force her. And so we talk about how you're not forcing your partner. You're helping get the ingredients in place for her to be willing. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, with a lot of patients who have ME/CFS and fibro, they often suffer disbelief from their partners about if this illness is real or if it's valid or if it's in their head.
Right.
So the bidding, which really resonated with me as well, do you have any tactical recommendations for if someone's experiencing that?
Right. I think that's such a good point. Because these individuals with ME/CFS and fibro, not only are they getting probably disbelief from their partners, but they've probably are getting a ton of disbelief from all the different physicians and healthcare providers that they see again and again and again. So they're just feeling invalidated and dismissed. Oftentimes we know in dyadic situations with couples where one partner has a health concern that's just not easily solvable or fixable. In particular, we're talking about heterosexual couples where the woman has this health concern and the man goes into fixer mode. Well, what can we do? Well, let's see more doctors. We got to figure this out. This can't really be real, right? Well, maybe you're just a little bit tired. Oh, come on. You didn't have pain the other day. Because the other partner probably wants to fix it. And they feel a little bit helpless and a little bit hopeless because they can't fix it. So my recommendation is stop trying to fix it. Right? Because every time that partner says, like, well, we could do this. Well, let's just see another doctor. Like, is it really, oftentimes it's not really helping. The best thing that partner can do is just listen. So there's a concept in couples therapy called the stress-reducing conversation. And the stress-reducing conversation essentially goes like this. You want to do it 20 minutes. Well, it doesn't have to be exactly 20 minutes, but at the end of the day, every day, for maybe about 20 minutes, where both partners get to talk. And in the stress-reducing conversation, there's a few key principles. One, you don't ever side with the enemy. So let's say your partner says, gosh, I just saw this doctor, and they totally dismissed me, and what a jerk. And so the worst thing the partner could do is say, like, well, I'm sure the doctor meant well. No, don't side with the enemy. So just support your partner. Empathize with them. Ugh, I could see how that is so frustrating. You've seen so many physicians and just you've continually been invalidated. I can see how frustrating that is. So you don't side with the enemy. You empathize with them. You do not problem solve. Unless they are saying to you, I want you to help solve this problem, you do not problem solve. You just listen. Those are the three components. And we know that happy couples, this is what they do every day. They have this stress-reducing conversation with their partner, just listens and doesn't problem solve and empathizes and doesn't side with the enemy. So I would take those three key principles and try to encourage the partner to say, even if you don't get it, even if you don't believe it, what you're doing right now probably isn't helping. Mm-hmm. So just try these three principles. Don't side with the enemy, be empathic, and don't problem solve, and see where that gets you. Any other questions?
So what happens if, you know, feelings start getting hurt? Is it just over, or can you talk your way back into having the desire or the willingness?
Say a little bit more about feelings start getting hurt, and is it over?
Well, so say, you know, partner initiates, and, you know, you've got too much on the brake pedal.
Yes.
And something's sad, or you start feeling bad because you're not up for it.
Right.
Once that happens, it just seems like the emotional part of it just kind of snowballs.
Such a good point, yeah. And then you get into an argument, and then you're like, well, I'm not going to initiate again because it's just going to turn into an argument. So what I would recommend is not when you are initiating sex or sex is being initiated. In a totally unsexy time, sit down and have a conversation with your partner about, hey, this is what my desire looks like. And I'm wondering, does your desire look like this other one? Yeah, like it looks different for us. So I need ingredients to be in place. I'll often talk with heterosexual couples about, it doesn't even have to be heterosexual couples. If your main desire is spontaneous desire, you are a microwave, right? Beep, 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 boop, you've heated up. If your main desire is willingness, you are a crock pot, right? Things take time. So sharing that at a totally non-sexual time with your partner, and then walking through, if you actually do those four columns on the sheet of paper, do that with your partner. And have them be next to you and say, like, these are the ingredients I want to see if we can get in place. And that will help them see that this is probably not as personal as they think it is, right? Because oftentimes the partner who initiates, if they get a rejection, they think, you don't love me, you don't want to be with me, they take it personal. But if they see, oh, our models of how we respond sexually are a little bit different, and these are some ingredients you need in place, and I can help you get those ingredients in place, and if we just can't get them in place, you want to counterbid to connect, okay, this isn't about whether you love me or not. But make sure you have that conversation, not in a moment of initiation. Anything else? These are great questions.
All right. Well,
okay.
No questions online. So thank you so much. Really appreciate it. Trip over the cord.
Thank you so much for having
me.
Thank you
so much. Really appreciate it.
Yes.
Really great.
Thank you, Jordan.
Very nice.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you.